Good morning and welcome to worship at Stairs Memorial United Church on yet another beautiful August Sunday. What is this with Sunday mornings this summer? Whatever it is, I'm glad of it. My name is Reverend Renee Clark, and in my other role, I serve as the spiritual care liaison for Northwood Long-Term Care. One of the perks of that is that it usually leaves me free on the weekends to help out in local churches when their own ministers need to be away. Last week, we expected would be my last Sunday with you, at least for a time, but the best laid plans take an unexpected twist. Reverend Catherine's not able to lead worship today, but hopes to resume her role next week. I thank you for having had me with you, and it's actually rather nice to have that extended a bit. This morning, we're going to continue in our series called Real Theology, where we take a look at some movies that raise theological themes and consider the ways that they might relate to our Christian walk. As we begin worship this morning, we acknowledge that we live and work and worship on lands that are the unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq people. As we gather, may we do so with respect for one another and for creation all around us. As we gather for worship, we light the Christ candle as a symbol of the light that came into the world in creation, a light fully revealed in Jesus Christ, a light that shines in the darkness, such that the darkness shall never overcome it. And we light the pride candle as a statement that all people are valued and welcome here, and we celebrate diversity in all its beautiful forms. Our opening song of meditation is I Am a Child of God. It should be on the screens, and Linda's going to lead us in the singing this morning. Byron's not here either. We think. Our call to worship is responsive and found both in the bulletins and on the screen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Our hymn this morning is Put Peace Into Each Other's Hands. It's a new one for me, so I'm especially glad Linda's up here to lead.
Put peace into each other's hands, and like a treasure hold it, protect it like a candle flame, with tenderness unfold it. Put peace into each other's hands, with loving expectation. Be gentle in your words and ways, in touch with God's creation. Put peace into each other's hands, like bread you trust and blessing, where words fall short, let hands speak out the heights of love expressing. Doubt in friendship, stay with me, in touch with those around you. Put peace into each other's hands, the peace that sought and found you.
We'll continue in prayer with our opening prayer, which is in unison. You'll find the words in the bulletins and again on the screens. Yahweh, you are most gracious to us. Many are your creative works. You provide us with comfort, love, guidance, and all that we need to thrive in the world you have created. You know the reason why we came to church today. Calm our minds that we may receive your word. Open our hearts that we may learn of your love. Prepare our spirits to be good stewards of your word and actions. This we ask in Christ's name. We turn to you, knowing that you understand us, forgive us, and love us like a mother. And so we pray with confidence and faith. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Have a seat. Have you ever wished you could predict the future? You wouldn't be alone in that. Some of the ways we try to predict it have some basis in science. Red sky at night, sailor's delight, and we've got a reasonable chance of a good day the next day. Others are pure chance. When I was a little girl, we used to make these paper gizmos that we called fortune tellers or cootie catchers. And you'd ask a series of questions while manipulating a piece of paper and unfolding a flap to reveal the purported answer. Children's storybooks are filled with fortune tellers and their crystal balls. There's the age-old plucking of the daisy. She loves me, she loves me not. The magic eight ball with its fluid and the floating dice with answers, flipping it over to see what the answer to the question might be. Relying on that groundhog to tell us how much longer winter might be. Why do we do these things? Because we want to know. Knowing what's going to happen or thinking we do helps us to feel more in control and more able to plan for our desired outcome. It's a very human thing for us, this wanting to know. And the more unstable a situation, often the harder we try and the more we want to control it. Sometimes in that wanting to know and control, we put our faith in the wrong things. We try to figure out life using only our own sense of what we think should be. And then we get upset or disappointed when things don't go our way. Ever get upset when something hasn't gone your way? I know I have more than once. And I suspect if we started sharing our stories of how that was for us and what that situation was for us, we could go on for the rest of the day. But you know, the Bible has something different to say about what we should rely on for happiness. And the way Jesus views success and value is much different from the way we usually define it. Jesus was talking to some people and he said that we would be blessed if we were sad or shy or poor in spirit or if someone else hurt us. He said that mourning people would be comforted and peacemakers would see God. The world will tell us to look for happiness in things, in power and in fame and in importance, all those things we want for ourselves. And often there's actually nothing wrong with those things in and of themselves. But God tells us that there's more and that we'll find it in the most unexpected of places. Jesus shares about this in the opening verses of a passage of scripture we've looked to more than once this summer, the Sermon on the Mount. Today, looking at Matthew 5, 1 to 12, which Gail is going to read for us.
Reading Matthew 5, 1 to 12. Now when he saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you."
Have any of you ever watched that cooking show, Chopped? There are four chefs, and during each of three rounds, they're given this mystery basket of ingredients that they must use to make a dish that includes all of those ingredients in some meaningful way. Often, most of the ingredients make sense, and there's some weird outlier that gets thrown in. After each of the rounds, the judges vote, and the chef whose dish was least interesting or just didn't work gets chopped. And this is kind of where we find ourselves this morning, Chopped, clergy edition. I have opened the mystery basket and been given Reverend Catherine's choice of movie and her appropriate scripture pairing. So let's see where that takes us, shall we? When I looked at them early this week, being familiar with the scripture reading and knowing something of the story of the Hadad family from the media coverage over the last number of years, I found myself with this odd scene unfolding in my mind, hearkening back to the 1979 Monty Python film Life of Brian. That scene from the Sermon on the Mount, where it's being delivered, and there's an elderly woman at the back of the crowd who's having difficulty hearing what is being said. And she asks loudly, "Speak up, I can't hear a thing. What did he say?" And the report from another member of the crowd as it gets passed back to her is, "Blessed are the cheesemakers." "The cheesemakers," she asks, "what's so special about them?" And another member of the crowd looks at her and says, "Oh, it's not meant to be taken literally. It applies to any of the manufacturers or distributors of dairy products." "Blessed are the chocolate makers." Okay, let's watch this thing. I'm actually quite glad I did. I hadn't seen it before this week. Based on a true story, Peace by Chocolate is a delightful Canadian movie filmed in 2020 that has swept independent film festival awards around the world. It features largely Arabic-speaking characters and previously little-known Canadian ones, with even a cameo from Justin Trudeau. And it tells the story of the Hadad family, who came from Syria via a refugee camp in Lebanon, and settled in Antigonish, Nova Scotia, or as they persist in calling it through the whole movie, Antigonish. Just know that going in. They're not locals. And they founded a chocolate-making business that later partnered with the Sobeys grocery store chain. I'll add to that that the family also now has a chocolate shop in the historic properties in Halifax, just steps away from the ferry terminal. It's beautiful and absolutely worth the trip to go over and have a look. And a nibble. But back to our movie. It begins with Tariq Hadad arriving at the airport in Halifax in the dead of winter 2016. being picked up by Frank Gallant, his wife Heather, and their friend Zariah. They bundle him up into a toque and a parka and a scarf and whisk him the 3 hours to Antigonish before he gets a chance to catch his breath. He articulates to them that his dream is to finish his medical school education and become a doctor. So they connect him with the local surgeon, who happens to be both the only surgeon in Antigonish and the only person of Lebanese descent in the community. He attempts to support Tariq in his efforts to gain entry to medical school without the usual degrees and transcripts, an effort that proves fruitless for Tariq time and time again. Tariq's parents, Isam and Shanaz, eventually follow Tariq to Antigonish, though they're very reluctant to leave Tariq's sister, Allah, and her daughter behind, which they must do as Allah's husband, Fadi, is missing, and she can't receive a visa for her daughter without his consent. The family is horrified by just how tiny Antigonish is, and seek transfer to Toronto, where they know people, and the population and the amenities are more similar to their native Damascus. But their lawyer is adamant that their sponsorship is tied to this church group in Antigonish, coordinated by Frank Gallant, who's been a strong support and a faithful friend to the family. The Hadads, alas, must stay in Antigonish. Isam and Shanaz speak only Arabic. They're totally dependent on Tariq to translate for them. And they actively resist his attempts to resume medical school. Without you, Isam says to his son at one point, I am illiterate here. One day while walking through town, Isam goes into a coffee shop where the proprietor, Kelly, also makes chocolates. Isam gets very excited and attempts to go behind the counter to show her how to improve them. Isam had been a chocolatier in Syria, owning a factory with 50 employees. Tariq apologetically removes his father from the shop, but the light bulb has gone on. Later, in the kitchen of their rented house, Isam makes homemade chocolates using ingredients purchased from Kelly and the family's ice cube trays as his molds. The spark of his passion has been reignited. Isam brings gifts of chocolate to the church group sponsors. They encourage him to make more, and soon he's selling them at the back of the church following services to rave reviews. Demand grows to the point that his sponsors are polling their friends to gather a loan to purchase a baby barn and more chocolate-making equipment. There is friction, though, with some in the town who believe in neighbors before newcomers. News reports of Trudeau's refugee policies in the face of the fear of terrorism and of ongoing bombings in Syria and Lebanon lend notes of tragedy and realism to the story. We've seen those stories. Tariq continues his efforts to try to get into medical school and accepts increasing numbers of public speaking engagements. His father wants him to stay home and support the family's chocolate business, and the conflict between them over this issue just continues to grow. Finally, after the death of her husband, Allah gets her visa to come to Canada with her small daughter. The family is reunited. Tariq sees the opportunity in asking his sister to take over the responsibility of supporting their parents in Antigonish and redoubles his efforts to accept even more speaking engagements in an attempt to gain that elusive entry to medical school to further his education. An executive from Sobeys shows up and approaches him about partnering in the family's business, which Tariq sees as an opportunity for growth. But he knows his father will resist as involvement of outsiders and authority of external investors. Tariq is accepted to medical school in Newfoundland. And he argues with Frank that the growth of the business should bring him more freedom and not less, and he should be able to go. The family is thrilled when Prime Minister Trudeau holds them up at a meeting of the United Nations as an example of what is possible when refugees are given the opportunity to develop new lives and businesses in their adopted communities. The Sobeys executive shows Tariq a set of plans for a new factory. Someone in the community causes issues for the Hadads with permits and food inspections. We can just see that happening, can't we? Later, Tariq attempts to pass the meeting with Isam and the executive off on Frank and his sister so that he can go to speak in Vermont. Tarek and Issam have an extended quarrel about sacrifice. Issam wants his son to respect the traditions he comes from, and Tarek wants his father to respect his dreams for something different and the sacrifices that he's made since they all came to Canada. In the way of young sons everywhere, Tarek storms off to Vermont. On the way, he's stopped and held at the US border because his documentation doesn't work, and he misses his speaking engagement. Issam suffers a heart attack from the quarrel and the stress of the anticipated Sobeys meeting and ends up hospitalized. Tarek rushes back to his father's bedside where they reconcile, and Issam is finally willing to consider the larger Sobeys invested factory. Frank feels edged out by the Sobeys executive and takes a step back from the business, but not from the friendship he's developed with Issam, whom he calls his brother. Issam works happily alongside the factory crew when it's complete. In a twist, Tarek declines his medical school admission and decides to focus on his family and the business for the time being, and accepts a board appointment with Nova Scotia Business Development. The film ends with a really moving scene between Tarek and Issam, in which Issam tells Tarek he'll be proud of him no matter what he does. And it fades through scenes of a happy family mealtime and Muslim worship together in the living room. The epilogue shows us footage of the Haddads in Etigan-ish and follows up on some of the film's storylines to the time of filming. I didn't mention that scene from Monty Python at the beginning without a plan to use it. The Monty Python scene I referenced about the cheesemakers has a pointed way of reminding us how often we get a little skew of what Jesus has said. It prompts us to think about who is blessed and who is not. That passage from Matthew should encourage us to think, who are the blessed ones anyway? Who is it that God favors and why? After all, when we look at the surface of this story of this refugee family who've lost their home and their friends and their extended family and their livelihood, all that they know, and find themselves trying to rebuild their lives in the tiny town of Etigan-ish, half a world away, it is a struggle to think of them as blessed. They have suffered so much. If you listen to the average televangelist, those who succeed in life are the ones that God favors. Those who gather in the three-piece suits and the fancy dresses in churches made of glass and steel, who have smiles on their faces and dollars in their pockets, and two well-behaved children beside them, and a nice new car in the parking lot. They are the blessed. But is that what Jesus taught? The Beatitudes are one of those passages that appears in more than one of the Gospels. We also find them in Luke, but with some significant differences. Instead of Matthew's straight up eight statements concerning those whom God will bless, Luke gives us four Beatitudes, four statements concerning those who are blessed that seem familiar enough. Blessed are you who are poor, blessed are you who are hungry, blessed are you who weep, blessed are you when people hate you and revile and defame you on account of the Son of Man. So far, they agree with each other. But then Luke goes on, and instead of listing four more Beatitudes, as the Matthew account does, he lists the four woes, four disturbing statements concerning those whom God will afflict. Woe to you who are rich, woe to you who are full, woe to you who are laughing and to whom all people speak well. So far, not so good. I think I want to go back to Matthew. But what does Jesus' list say about our aspirations, about our dreams? What does this list of blessings and woes, if you look at Luke's account, say about what God is about where God is? William Willimon writes this. He says, for Jesus, there was something more dangerous than tears. It was the dangerous deception that our world is secure, stable, the best of all possible worlds. Don't worry, be happy. Jesus warns of that deception. Woe to you that laugh now. Woe if you feel too good, settled too comfortably with the way things are.
To hope too soon, to laugh too easily is self-deception. The reduction of the Christian hope to election campaign fluff. And as much as we hate to admit it, Willimon is right. I don't know about you, but I need to know that God is with me the way I really am. And that that image of joy and success and happiness and prosperity that we get thrown at us 24 hours a day on television and online, that image that we can't seem to make real for ourselves no matter how hard we try, is a false image and not really what God's blessing is about at all. What we're confronted with here in the Beatitudes, what we're confronted with here is the love of God, a love that takes us just as we are, and so also takes the poor, the thirsty, the sorrowful, those who are despised, just as they are. According to Matthew and in the Sermon on the Plain and the Gospel according to Luke, there's an assurance of joy on the other side of grief, laughter on the other side of tears, fulfillment on the other side of hunger, and a reward that isn't always what we expect. I think Tariq found that out, what he thought he wanted, what he thought meant success, and what he later found to be success, looked like two very different situations. I love a good time, a good joke, an opportunity to forget my problems and the problems of the world all around me. It feels good to just shut everything out and relax, right? I don't know about you, but I feel God's presence most not in those times, not in the good times, not in the easy times, the times when I'm blind to the pain within me and the pain around me. I sense God's presence most, when I'm actually helping someone who's in need. That's why the experience of the church group people in the movie resonates so much with me, and I would suspect with you if you're able to watch it. Knowing this is a congregation that's also been involved in refugee sponsorship, I think you'll recognize yourself in some of the challenges. I feel it most when someone looks me in the eye and says to me, or listens to me say to them, God understands. What that tells us is that all is never lost, that God is able to work with us, to accomplish something for us and in us and through us when we're open about that need. Happiness, blessedness, is not found in wealth, in 3 square meals a day, in mindless laughter or the good opinion another person might have of us. It's found in letting go, in knowing our need and the need of the world around us, in knowing that we're in a relationship with a God who actually does care about those needs, that God is present with us to meet those needs. Blessedness is found in trusting God, in doing the work of God, the work of loving and caring and healing and sharing and forgiving. That's what our scripture this morning tells us. Blessed are the cheesemakers, the chocolate makers, for theirs is the kingdom of God. The Hadad's motivation is clear here, to rebuild their lives and to bring joy to others by sharing their talent. We may relate more easily to the sponsors in the movie, to Frank and Heather and Zariah. We do good things all the time. This is a congregation with a particularly strong history in that regard, and it shines through in your vision for the future of Stairs as you've laid it out in those foundational documents. But why? What's our motivation? We know that many good things happen here. You don't need me to tell you that. What we're encouraged to step back and ask ourselves is, why do we do what we do? Why do we give? Why do we serve? What does God expect from us anyway? That's the question that the Old Testament prophet Micah answers with those famous words. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with God? God expects us to act justly when we're given the opportunity, to show our love for God by doing what is right and just in the lives of other people. And that begins right where we live. It involves being willing to put ourselves out there, to be a voice for those who are oppressed by whatever circumstance in their lives. Socioeconomics, gender, age, religion, sexual orientation, politics, every person who, for whatever reason, is treated as anything less than the child of God that they are. It can seem overwhelming. There are so very, very many of them. But remember the story of the Good Samaritan from Luke 10. It was only last week, people. He didn't respond to the needs of all of the wounded people in the world, but he did respond to the needs of the wounded person sitting in his path. That's what it's all about, to make the world that we live in a better place, for the glory of God and the sake of the person in front of, beside, or behind us. Our response to knowing that loving kindness of God is to desire to share it with others, in the commitment and the dependability that arises from mutual relationship, the kind of relationship we see developing between Fred and Isam in the movie. To live in that kind of relationship is to be committed not only to God, but to a quality of life governed by principles of mutual respect, helpfulness, and loving concern. God expects us to love and get along with one another, to treat one another justly and fairly, to love mercy and show kindness to one another, to allow our hearts to be broken by the things that break the heart of God. It's a deep desire to see the world through God's eyes, to act in the world as God would act, to stop listening to ourselves for a moment, just a moment, pausing long enough to listen for the voice of God in whatever way we're able to hear it. For God speaks to us in a myriad of ways, friends. Listening to others and how they make sense of their world. Listening to how people make sense of their lives. Considering what it means to live with faith. There is so much that we can learn from one another. So much that we can offer one another. It's finding ways to say to one another, I have something that I want to share with you. And you have something, and I hope you will share it with me. That's the kind of mutual relationship and sharing we see in Peace by Chocolate. Hand in hand with our brothers and sisters around the world, may we join hands with the God who creates, redeems, and sustains us all. Now, and forevermore. Amen. There is no reflective music. Okay. In which case, we'll move directly to our hymn, which is August 28th, Deep in Our Hearts, number 154.
Deep in our hearts,
justice and peace in harmony. Deep in our hearts, there is a common longing. Deep in our hearts, there is a common theme. Deep in our hearts, there is a common current, flowing to freedom like a stream. Deep in our hearts, there is a common vision. Deep in our hearts, there is a common song. Deep in our hearts, there is a common story, telling creation that we are one.
Turn to the words of a new creed, found on page 918 if you're using the books or also on the screens. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect to creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us, we are not alone. Thanks be to God.
A small united church with big history. Since Jesus first walked on this earth, Christians have been spiritually drawn to make pilgrimages to places connected to his birth, life, crucifixion, resurrection, and legacy. Today, pilgrimage hotspots include Obermergrabu in Germany, Lourdes and Taizé in France, and of course, the Holy Land. Here in Canada, thousands of Christians, pilgrims make their way to the small town of Napanee, Ontario, to visit Old Hay Bay Church each year. The last Sunday in August is the highlight of the season, when the church hosts its annual pilgrimage service. What's the attraction? It's a mix of the history, scenery, spiritual connection, and community. An unassuming building clad with gray wood siding and wide doors that open to a plain but sturdy sanctuary. Old Hay Bay Church was originally built on the shoreline of Hay Bay, which connects to the Bay of Quinte in 1792. It is the oldest Methodist building and one of the oldest churches in Canada. Now it belongs to the United Church of Canada, and your generosity through mission and service helps ensure that it will continue to be a place of pilgrimage for years to come. Elaine Farley, chair of the Board of Trustees and one of the church's custodians, explains that the building, originally referred to as the Meeting House, was the center of the rapid growth of Methodism and hosted the first camp meeting in 1805. Methodism grew into the largest Protestant group in Canada and was the largest communion that became the United Church in 1925, she says. The founders reflect any United Church congregation today. They came from various countries of origin and had a wide variety of skills and knowledge, but together they made a strong voice, speaking of God, their community, and their future. Farley warns that she could enthusiastically go on and on about why the small church in rural Ontario is so important, but she sums it up with three short sentences. Old Hay Bay Church has earned its place in the history of Methodism and the United Church of Canada. It is not just a building, but also a sacred place of our ancestors, as well as a pilgrimage place for us and our descendants. It has a special place in people's hearts. Thank you for helping to preserve important historical, theological, and pilgrimage sites through your mission and service gifts.
Thanks, Gail. We pause at this point in our work to give thanks to God for the love and care so freely given to us. And we respond to that with our own gifts, that from the fruits of our labors and the fruits of our hearts, to be blessed as we continue to seek justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with God. The offering box was on the table at the back as you came in. You may have had a chance to give in that way. If you haven't and you'd like to, there will be offering plates at the doors on your way out as well. During the singing of our offering hymn, "We Praise You, O God," the box will be brought forward. Loving God, we are grateful for the opportunity to give, for it reminds us that we have been blessed, and blessed for a purpose to be a blessing to others. So we ask that each of these gifts, large or small, be put to the best use of the furthering of your kingdom in this place. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Welcome to have a seat. Let's come before God in prayer together. Living God, as we gather in your name, help us to hear your word, that we might understand, that in understanding we might believe, and that in believing we might follow in faithfulness and obedience, seeking your honor and your glory in all that we do. Help us to find the humility and the courage, the boldness and the grace, that in our loving and our being loved, we might somehow ignite our world with a compassion so fierce that violence and abuse, rejection and condemnation, neglect and greed become unthinkable relics of the past. So we pray for new hearts, for new ways of being, for the courage and the vision to build our world on different values, those that you teach us, humility and service, compassion and generosity and integrity. May your will be done not only around the world, not only in our community around us, but here among us, within us, and most of all through us, for we ask it in the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus, who became the Christ. Amen. The announcements are on slides on your screen, but as those are scrolling by us, I also want to pause for a moment to see if there's anything that we need to share or highlight, things that are happening that we need to know. This is your opportunity, and hello, Jim.
Good morning. I'll wear my chairman's hat for a minute. First of all, Byron earned our music director very, can you hear me?
Yep.
well-earned a week off, and because of his technical abilities, we won't be passing any cheese here. I had comments last week that several people had said they'd never heard every word spoken during the service. They did last week, so it's wonderful to hear. We're all indebted to Byron for that, Jack. Thank you for stepping in, providing music today. Linda, too, your solos. Reverend Clark, we spoke last Sunday after service at coffee time. You said you had a major commitment every day this week, and your week was chock-a-block full. Thank you for coming to our rescue today. I won't say goodbye, I'll say until next time, perhaps. Yeah. And lastly, 2 weeks from today, 11th of September, there will be a congregational meeting after the service. Reverend McDonald will be here to help us lead that, and there'll be some business that has to be brought to the congregation. So I have to formally announce that today. Thank you.
Okay. Is there anything else we need to highlight for folks? Okay, by all means. You might want to go over to the mic to make sure that folks can hear you.
Is there anyone here who doesn't know me? I'm Lorna Randall. My name was just on the screen, but we've been a fair trade church here since 2008. We like to give the coffee, cocoa, and tea growers around the world a fair break. So that's our goal. To that end, I'm placing an order tomorrow. Anyone who's already given me your order, it's been placed already, and tomorrow they're giving me an extra day to finish off the order. So also today, for the first time in weeks, I will have the pantry shop set up downstairs. So thank you for your ongoing support.
Is there anyone else who has anything they'd like to bring forward? We'll continue our threshold into the world with the singing of our next hymn, which is Make Me a Channel of Your Peace, number 684.
Make me a channel of peace, where there is safety, let me bring your love, where there is injury, your
make me a channel.
Let us go in peace, and may God grant to each one of us a living hope and a spirit of love, wisdom, and compassion, that we may be ones who both know our own needs and the God who meets them. May we rejoice in God's presence among us, both now and forevermore. Amen. Our song of dismissal, may the God of hope go with us.
And we know he will.
He will, whether we have music or not. But Jack is looking busy up there, so I still have hope.